Let's keep continuing. And next topic that we are going to see is overloading. Now, the concept of overloading is it's defined as more, it is, we want to get more out of one function. And that's when we call function overloading. So you want to use one same function and you want it to do or to be able to perform multiple tasks for you. In the same way, when we are talking about operator overloading, we want to use the same operator and we want it to be smart enough to perform multiple tasks for you depending on the context. So this diagram over here differentiates your overloading and concept of overriding. Again, if you are new to this word of overriding, please look up the definition. But that's an object-oriented concept, and these two concepts are most confused with each other. And that's where I think this diagram tries to illustrate the big difference between both, where overloading is having multiple arrows. So you have a same function, which is your bow, and you want things to do, you want your functions to perform different activities depending on context, as you have three different arrows over here. So you want it to perform hit three different targets whenever you need them. But overriding is something more like combining one arrow with the other, as you see it's tied over here, where you are not necessarily intended to perform different functions, but you are using combining the functionalities of two different arrows of the functions. So one of the example of function overloading is if you have overloaded functions, what remains same among them and what's different among them? So overloaded functions will have same name. That's how you say that these are overloaded functions. If they have different names, they are two different functions, right? So they have same name, and along with same name, they have same scope because they have same name. Both comes implied. But in order to be, if they have same name, same scope, and everything same, then it's basically the same function. So what's that part of overloading that differentiates its functionality depending on context? That part is it has different parameters or argument list. So as you see here in this class rectangle, we have function set size that is overloaded. Set size has same name. All this has same name. So that's an overloaded function. What's different among them is the parameters. So different arguments and parameters that it's passing. Number of arguments is different, and also the type of arguments is different. Like it's passing two int, it's passing two float. It's just passing one int, one float. First float and then int, a float, nothing. And that's what makes the function overloaded. What's the purpose of overloaded function? Can somebody think of that? Well, sometimes you want same function. For example, let's go back to the same example of class rectangle. If you are setting size of the rectangle can have length and breadth, right? There are two parameters, height and width. Now, height could be a float, width could be a float, both could be int. There can be variations depending upon what rectangle are you considering. Maybe your rectangle does not exist. In that case, there can be nothing. Maybe your rectangle is a square. In that case, your height is equal to breadth. But more important than that, what is this height? That would define if it's an int or a float. So in that case, if you want this something that you're doing using the class rectangle, to operate over all these different variations of types of rectangles you can have, then you want to overload these functions that you are using in class rectangle. And set size is just one example of that overloaded function. So the compiler identifies different versions of the function by its unique signature. What this signature consists is, first, it has the function name in its signature, and second, it has parameter types in this signature. So with these two things, it makes its signature. Function name is same across all the overloaded functions, and parameter type is something that's different across overloaded functions. So combining these two things, we can make a unique signature for each overloaded function. So for example, for the rectangle class, the set size function that we overloaded, that can have a signature like set size, that's the function name, int. This is a unique signature. Set size int, that's a unique signature. Set size float, that's a unique signature. That's how the compiler is going to refer to that overloaded function. Changing the return type does not change the signature, as you see over here, because the signature does not contain or does not store the return type. For example, if you have a function getSizeInt, and that function is returning int, versus if you have a function where I think there's an error where I want to show, if you have a function getSizeInt that's returning a float, then in this case, for both of these functions, the signature will remain same in spite of one returning int and other returning float, because in signature, we are not storing the return type. Now, given that, if just the return type is different, is these two functions, int get size int and float get size int, is it an example of, is it an overloaded function? Is get size an overloaded function or not? Well, if you read the next line of the same slide, you should have your answer there. Overloaded function can have different return types. So different overloaded functions, like let's say, for example, set size, when it has different input arguments, it can have different return type. It does not restrict its return type, but the example of get size, if the name is same, and if your input argument is exactly same, right, then you don't store, this is the total amount of information that you store in the signature. And then the signature of overloaded function is not able to differentiate just with your return type, void, int, or int and float or something, that these two is an overloaded function. And that's why there will be a problem. Now, what will be this problem? Write a example code to resolve your curiosity and see what's the output that you get when you do this thing. But that being said, if you have different arguments, then overloaded function allows you to have different return types. You can have different return types in overloaded function, but does only having different return types sufficient for it to operate as an overloaded function? That's something you should figure out by writing your own program. And if you have questions, then see you in the office hours. Next, we will talk about operator overloading. That's the concept of same as function overloading, but rather than the function, now we are dealing with operators. Now, as soon as we say word operator, something that must trigger your mind is there are different types of operator that your compiler considers, such as unary operator, binary operator, ternary operator. this unary, binary, that categorization depends on how many arguments this operator takes. Some operator just take one argument, unary operator, some operator takes two arguments, for example, plus, minus. You need an argument before that and you need an argument after that. That makes them binary and so on and so forth. So when you are dealing with operator, their nature of being unary, binary, that cannot be changed, that remains the same. But still, with that being same, you can still overload this operator. For example, the operator of addition can add ints or it can concatenate string, right? For example, if you are using operator of addition for 10 plus 9, that should result 19, that's adding int. Or if I'm using the addition operator to concatenate strings, then if I have something like this plus class, then what result will it give is this class. It will concatenate two different strings together. So this then, if this addition operator is able to perform both this function, then that addition operator is an overloaded operator. The operator plus, minus, multiplication, equal to, double equal to, less than, greater than, they do different things depending on the type of parameters. So if we have a version of plus, where we pass plus by using int, it would do one thing. It will give you result as addition of two different numbers. While if you give the parameters as string, then it will perform differently. It's doing different tasks where it's concatenating two strings. And this is operator overloading. And when you have overloaded operators, then there are many different intricacies, intricate details that's going on what's happening again behind the curtains, right? Like when you want to concatenate string, you need to allocate a new string that is of size of the character of the first string plus the character of the second string. Then you need to copy the character of first string into the first characters of that new string that you allocated. And after you are done with that, then you have to copy the character of the second string into the next successive space of that new allocated thing. So if you are using an overloaded operator, then you don't have to do all these things manually. So it shields you from that complexity of doing everything. There are some restrictions on what operators you can overload and what operators you cannot overload. Some of the operators that you cannot overload are the ones that are listed over here. So for example, the scope resolution operator, your compiler would not, that's a limitation from C++. So your compiler wouldn't allow you to overload that operator. But almost apart from this list of operators, you can overload any other operator, plus, minus, multiply, divide, all those. The arity of the operator, as I said, operator being unary, binary, and so on and so forth. That arity of the operator, as we already discussed, it cannot be changed. So if you're overloading an additional addition operator, it should, if the arity is two, that means it should take two arguments in even in the overloaded scenario. If you are overloading plus plus operator, the arity of this operator is one, right? What we do, A plus plus, B plus plus, plus plus A, plus plus Y, something like that. So the arity is one, only one additional parameter goes with this plus, plus, minus, minus, all those operators. And even if you are overloading it, it will still take just one operator with it or one variable with it. Overloading does not change also the precedence apart from arity. What is precedence? Well, the compiler has an order of performing different operations in different priority. For example, give more importance to perform addition upon division, something like that. So compiler has it set, and even when you overload the operator, that precedence cannot be changed. So if it's prioritizing addition over division operator, even while you overload the addition and division operator, it will still prioritize the overloaded addition over division. And then we cannot change how operators behave on built-in type. That would be a violation of our simple understanding, right? For example, what we are doing in this example is a violation. We are taking two terms, LHS and RHS, and we are trying to overload operator add to actually do subtract rather than add. This is something against our understanding. So then if this is allowed, what would happen is in that program, whenever you add, rather than adding, it will subtract. So that's why this is something we should not do. It's not allowed. And at least one operator must be user-defined class. Otherwise, redefining the same thing is kind of useless, right? Because if you are overloading an operator, then you want to overload it with something that's user-defined, something that the system is not doing it by itself. If you overload addition operator by adding to int, system would do it by itself whenever you use addition operator. So there's no point of overloading it then. If you want to do concatenation of string by using addition operator, then it makes sense to overload addition operator. So something like that. So these are the rules you need to take care of whenever you are using operator overloading. Now, operator overloading with class member functions. Let's just take a very brief glimpse at this. This is a pretty complex concept depending on if you're using class member functions, if you're using friend functions. Again, if friend functions doesn't ring a bell, textbook is your best friend. So operator overloading with class member functions. There you have a new member function within the class with the left-hand operand, which must be an object. So your left-hand operand, while you are overloading a new member function, that must be an object of that operator. So the implicit, this is the operator, and then you have the parameters of that operator. LHS is used to call the overloaded function, right? As we had in the function overloading, we are using this to call our overloaded function, right? And that's where the name of the function which needs to be same. In the same way, while you are using operator overloading with class member functions, right? You're overloading an operator, but you're using it with class member functions. So even in that case, your LHS is used to call the overloaded function, and your RHS is used to pass the parameters. Like over here, your RHS is used for parameters and your LHS is used to call the overloaded function. Now, depending on the scenarios of if you're using a overloaded operator with a friend function or overloaded operator with a member function, the way you call overloaded operator or define overloaded operator will be different. If you're using it with friend function, if we are overloading operator plus, then we would have to say that, okay, this is the class, this is the operator that you're overloading. And this operator has parameters such as const send and the value. So as you see the difference of using overloaded operator with member functions, you don't have that first argument, which a friend function would have, because it's not a member function of the class itself, but it's a friend of a class, and we're using the function of that. And while returning, again, it has some extra arguments, like we need to say what friend, this like which class this function is friend of sense, and the remaining arguments are same. M dot sent plus value, M dot sent plus value, and we are returning the sense. So you can overload function in a class. You can overload function in the friend functions, member functions, all that. You can overload, you can overload operator by itself in the class or in the function. You can also overload operator while using friend function or while using member function. These are different functionalities of overloading. YouTube, I also think, is a good resource for learning about overloading, because sometimes reading the context does not make things that clear to you, but watching the context on some animated, so I put some links over here, those are like animated content, and that visual representation will allow you to understand overloading better. But if you are looking online, then be careful to look multiple sources and not just rely on single source, because there are chances of false information online too. So if you don't, we don't want your concept to be built on that. So first read the textbook. That's definitely the truthful information. If, in order to understand the textbook, the information that you read in the textbook better, you can use online information as your reference, apart from textbook, and you can watch videos, this, that. But when you do that, you got to be, if there is something wrong that's presented, then you got to be able to recognize that. And that's the whole reason, first rely on your textbook. Again, if you have any questions, you know the drill, please feel free to join the office hours, get the details on Canvas about when they'll be held, the Zoom link.